you know, the advanced braking things are obviously much more advanced and maybe, you know, maybe a little more difficult for the do-it-yourselfer to kind of fix. So obviously that type of customer may not necessarily be required, but obviously you're going to have to service those parts at some point. I mean, is that a strategy you guys are getting into?
Very much so. So just to comment on that, though, the actual wheel end components, just like you were saying earlier, the caliper, the rotor, the pad, it's still there. But what's happened is so for someone to change the parts, it's no different than it was 20 years ago to change the parts. But the material choices are what's far more critical. I mean, you can imagine material choices got more critical when cars went to ABS. And now even more so as they've gone to the automated braking. Because, you know, think about it. Nowadays, a newer car, and it's not just a luxury feature, it's on all base models too now. And I think by 2022, it's going to be mandated across the board. I could have the date screwed up, but something like that.
Yeah.
A car is going to see a hazard and it's going to go, you know, I know better than you to stop the vehicle. So, and in fact, it can identify a hazard and react to it in 2 or 3 tenths of a second, whereas it might take us 2 seconds.
Yeah.
So, I mean, basically it can react 10 times faster. So the components that are doing the work have to be very specific. So the way we look at it, you have to be very careful about the selection of the product that goes in that wheel end, that corner now. Mm-hmm. That friction material has got to be as close as possible to what came out of the car originally to match up with what the electronics thinks. You know, if the electronics thinks it can stop in 100 feet or sees a hazard in 100 feet and thinks it can stop in 90, you better put materials in that can do the same job. Because if you don't, and you put materials where now it thinks it could stop in 90, but it's stopping in 110, you have a problem.
So,
honestly, I don't know how that's going to work as this thing rolls out and these cars starts getting serviced in the aftermarket and someone does get into a situation and they didn't put the right friction in. I mean, I kind of shudder to think what will happen next.
Yeah,
you know, person, but just from a legal standpoint, what's going to happen to the aftermarket as things like this are addressed. So since we started, we've been very focused on that. And we're very, very careful about the friction selection.
Got it.
Especially for our premium programs.
Yeah. And the one about like the EV and regen, I mean, that's a little bit, obviously it's a different type of technology. So does that play a role in the friction selection too, as far as like the EV, the Teslas or whatever the world?
Oh, absolutely. Well, first they have another set of problems. So first of all, they're great because, I mean, they do a lot of regenerative braking, right? So you're not even touching the brake pedal much of the time to slow the car down.
Yeah.
So that creates another set of problems where, because of their lack of use, their biggest problem is corrosion.
Yeah.
Right? So now they have to be working with different materials so the rotor doesn't corrode, and on the rotor. And then separately on the friction, what they want to do now, they don't want to have or use a typical adherent type friction material. They want to use an abrasive, something that's constantly cleaning. So that was kind of funny when we first were looking at this and before we started to get a real understanding of what was going on, we're like, wow, this is a very, very quiet vehicle. Talking about a Tesla, let's say. Mm-hmm. And then they were coming with these typical European low metallic pads, which have a tendency to make noise, frankly. And so it's amazing that on such a quiet vehicle, they'd be using these pads. And then it wasn't until a couple of years later, after going to many, you know, these conferences and understanding what's going on, that the OEs, at the OE level, they were putting these types of materials on to clean the rotor. That's really what it was all about. It wasn't about, had nothing to do with high performance braking or any of the other benefits that you get from that type of material. It was to clean the rotor. So it's like, wow.
Yeah. So are they going to start making the pads thinner in a Tesla then? So just so they get you.
Well, I mean, they could. I can tell you that on the Prius, for example, they, you know, that's a 3,300 pound vehicle, and that uses the same size brake system as the what's that small Toyota? Anyways, it's a 2,400 pound Toyota. Yaris.
Gotcha.
Right? Same pad, same caliper, same rotor dimension, same, basically the same system, but only packaged differently to fit in that envelope, but the same size. So, you know, Toyota wouldn't do that unless there was a really good reason. Well, they don't need to, right? So they could use a cheaper system to stop the vehicle that's, you know, relying mainly on the regenerative braking to stop.